back from the dead. So today we get to talk about something that I have been wanting to chat about for a while. We had to wait for the Slender Man doc to come out on HBO. Hopefully you guys caught it. If you didn't, spoiler alert, don't watch my review if you think it's gonna affect you. I doubt it will because you've probably read or heard about, you know, what happened with the Slender Man stabbings. Let's just start out by saying that this is what nightmares are made of. So I'm basically gonna break this into three separate parts of a review slash chat. The first part is going to be, you know, HBO's part, Creepypasta's involvement, and the history behind Slender Man. The second part is going to be my opinion on the two girls that did the actual stabbing, which is Anissa and Morgan, against their friend Peyton slash Bella. And the third part of the discussion is going to be paranormal relevance. What could paranormal have to do with this? So the big question is, what is Slender Man? June 10th, 2009, Slender Man is born on an alternate universe of the internet, not Creepypasta. He is depicted as this tall, thin, creepy, lurking, no face, pale white figure that is always captured via Photoshop, lurking over children, like on playgrounds, in museums. He sneaks into bedrooms at night. And the theme is he kidnaps your children. So it's kind of up in the air what happens to the kids after that. Some stories or legends claim he eats the children and sometimes people. Other legends are that you can become a servant of Slender Man, and he almost becomes this figure of he's going to take care of the children in some strange alternate universe. So 2013, 2014, the Slender Man, has now been built up since 2009, and he goes viral on Creepypasta. If you're not familiar what Creepypasta is, it's basically a website where people start contributing to each story of all of these different characters or legends or the people that bring them up. And to the date, Slender Man is at a PDF of 194 pages, and it's anonymous contributors that have made the story of Slender Man over time. It's claimed, like, if he gets provoked in a certain way, he has tentacles that come out of his back. He's basically a non-faced, no-faced demon that has come up to take your children. Why does this appeal to people or an audience on the internet? Well, people that follow the story of the Slender Man claim they like the fourth wall being broken, they like the Blair Witch vibe. He has an actual symbol, which is really rare for something that's kind of on the dark side versus like a superhero. And the symbol is like a circle with X's through it. And it's claimed if you spot this or see this, he is coming or he has already been there. So what happened May 31st, 2014? Two girls, one named Morgan, one named Anissa, had been basically planning their attack on their friend Peyton, aka Bella, since December of the following year, 2013. So that's like, what, 6 months they've been planning this out? May 31st, 2014, it's a Saturday. They ended up having like a sleepover on the night before on a Friday. They wake up early. They ask their mom if they can go to the park. They lure this friend into a bathroom in the park, okay? This is, so it's like the weird part. They have had several different ideas between Anissa and Morgan on how to commit this murder. So wait, back up a second. Why are they murdering someone to begin with? According to Creepypasta and different sites they've seen, including the Slender Man, if you murder someone for or in the name of Slender Man, you can become a proxy slash servant and go live with Slender Man in his wonderful wooded mansion with a bunch of other creepy characters that he lives with. So Morgan and Anissa essentially wanted to become his proxy slash servants. That was why they were killing this girl in the name of Slender Man. They also claimed that they had been in communication with Slender Man. Or I guess mainly Morgan claims she had been in communication with Slender Man and that he was going to kill their families if they did not actually commit this crime. They both were later diagnosed with mental illness. Let's go back to the story. They go to the playground this Saturday morning. They go inside of the bathroom on the playground. They want to kill Peyton, aka Bella, in the bathroom because there is a drain. So they think if they kill her with the blood, it will go down this drain. So Anissa has this idea that she's going to slam Peyton's head into the back of a brick wall and knock her out because she doesn't want to kill someone who's looking at her in the eyes. She said she wouldn't be able to do it if someone was watching her. Ew. Like total classic serial killer mode right here. After they like basically knock Peyton out, I don't think she remembered what happened. They wanted her to go to sleep. They waited a while. Peyton didn't go to sleep. She ended up getting up, and that's when they lured her into the actual woods. Once they get her in the woods, Morgan had stolen a knife from her parents' kitchen before they left and showed it to Anissa. And they kind of made this blood bond pact that they're going to go out and kill her in the name of Slender Man. And they get her in a compromising position in the woods. Anissa kind of chickens out at the last minute, decides that she can't do it. Morgan ends up taking it upon herself to attack Bella, aka Peyton, gets her on the ground and stabs her 19 times. They end up kind of getting hysterical over the entire event. Peyton is bleeding really badly on the ground. Anissa gets down to console her, tells her to, you know, lay down slowly, that you don't want to move fast because you'll bleed out faster and you'll die. And Morgan and Anissa end up running to like the darker wooded area, and they are going to go find Slender Man's mansion, which is like 4 or 5 hour drive north of where they're at. So I can't imagine how long it would take walking. They eventually end up getting caught on the side of the road by some sort of a deputy who takes them in, who has no idea that they just committed basically attempted murder. It's crazy, right? In the meantime, Peyton, aka Bella is her middle name. The news reports refer to her as Peyton. Her actual name to Morgan and Anissa is Bella, so that's why I'm going to use both of her names. She ends up crawling to basically like this sidewalk area where a cyclist ends up like driving past her and sees this girl bleeding out everywhere and ends up helping save her life and calling 911, and she's rushed into the emergency. Peyton, aka Bella, is saved and somehow survives 19 stab wounds in the woods while her friends are off chasing Slender Man. All right, now going into watching the footage, if you guys saw the documentary, it is shot by HBO, which of course we know is Game of Thrones. I'm not the biggest Game of Thrones enthusiast. I've seen a few episodes. But of course, HBO is really hardcore about their cinematography, the producers they have on set. This was considered a single solo docu, show. It wasn't a series. And it was, of course, shot beautifully, as we would expect from HBO. They took some of the pictures from Creepypasta of Slender Man and brought him to life. It was kind of animated. And it gave you more of a visualization of what these girls may have been experiencing in their mind as they were believing this creature. So once the girls are hauled in by the police, Morgan is telling the police what happened, and she's saying that Slenderman is a mind reader, that he watches her. He knows how to teleport. It gets crazy. Morgan has some severe mental illness. And then Morgan ends up, you know, going into jail, or actually I think she's being withheld in some sort of an asylum at this point. And now she's starting to claim that Voldemort, which is the guy from Harry Potter, he's the evil guy from Harry Potter, Morgan claims Voldemort comes to visit her, and that some of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles come to visit her. I wish Michelangelo would come visit me, I'm just saying, okay? As a kid, when we would play TMNT, I was always Michelangelo. Of course I was. Being serious, they end up telling the judge, like, this girl has some serious hallucinations, and the judge declares Morgan incompetent for trial. Oh my god, this is seriously a parent's worst nightmare, like, what happens with this. I quote, the officer interviews Morgan and Anissa, but staying on Morgan. The officer says, do you feel, you know, remorse or regretful for stabbing Peyton or Bella? And I quote, guys. In fact, I'm going to give you the quote right here, okay? Morgan says, it's easier to live without regrets if you decide you don't want to feel. It's either straight up an emo kid or that is terrifying. Evidence continues on the Morgan side, which is Morgan has mutilated Barbie dolls that are found in her bedroom that are missing hands and feet. They're, quote, called the soft spots of where you should attack your victims. She has these Barbie dolls that have the Slenderman symbol drawn all over them in the, quote, soft spots, the chest, the head, the neck, main arteries, basically, is what I'm assuming what they're showing. And one of the papers that they find inside of her jail cell, or if she's in the asylum, they never make it clear in the beginning where she's being held, but they find papers that say, quote, I love killing people, and it's like a drawing of a girl dead in a pool of blood with another girl over her with like a weapon saying, I love killing people. Where were they walking to when they got caught? Nicolette National Forest, which is north of where they were. Waukesha, Wisconsin, is where this happened at. Anissa was interviewed as well. She had done like some drawings and stuff like that of Slenderman. It wasn't anything portraying like Morgan did with like the Barbie dolls and such, but it was still pretty dark. During the interviews, both of the girls basically were blaming each other. Morgan says it was all Anissa. Anissa says it was all Morgan, and stories kind of get jumbled. It was a 6-month discussion on killing someone in the name of Slenderman. So I think that they'd contribute, one would contribute and the other would contribute. And I think that's where this whole thing got built. Now let's go into what I witnessed, and I'm sure you saw it if you watched the documentary, and what I think about this behind as far as my opinion on it. First of all, I can't help but watch this from a parent's point of view, and I mean all of the parents involved. I don't know if you guys really know this about me, but I don't have kids of my own yet, but I do have a second, she's my second cousin that I raised. I had custody of her for many years, and she's like my daughter. She's like my mini-me, it's Hannah. She is 15 now, but, I can remember when she was 12, and I'm looking at Hannah at 12 compared to these girls, and I'm just kind of in shock at the situation of what's happening. So let's just chat about that. So the first parents that you meet in the documentary are Morgan's parents. I hate to say this, but you can definitely tell Morgan's mother is probably on some sort of Zoloft or an anti-anxiety drug or probably antidepressants, which she has every right to be considering her child, you know, is going through some shit and tried to kill someone with attempted murder. And so her mother has some very strange facial expressions and the way that she's reacting to things that the producers are obviously asking her. And I mean that because sometimes she'll have a discussion and she'll have a statement come out of her mouth. And then at the end, she's like, And you're sitting there as an audience member going, why are you laughing? Your daughter is up for attempted murder. What's so funny? Why are you smiling? There's nothing you should be smiling about. And it's not that, it's the drugs basically telling her body to function this way that, yes, this is a sad story, but try to be happy about it. Because she doesn't break down once. So her Morgan's mother ends up going in to discuss that. They knew she was into Slender Man, but she also liked Stephen King books, and they thought it was just like this dark phase. And so I can kind of see where she thought it was innocent, or it should have been innocent. Apparently, Anissa is the one that introduced not only creepypasta to Morgan, but also the Slender Man to Morgan. So Morgan's mom says that she didn't really see any strange signs. Her and Anissa were kind of like the weird kids of the class that cloned. They didn't have a lot of friends. Everybody kind of looked at them strange. Immediately when I heard that come out of Morgan's mother's mouth, I thought that was a very similar situation with Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold from Columbine. They were, kind of outcasts, and they felt like they were very alone, and so they bonded together. So Morgan's mom is very strangely disconnected to the situation. There's not a lot of emotions, but I think that she is definitely on something to help her function, since, her daughter is no longer there with her at home, and at the age of 12, 14, she should be home. As the story goes on during the documentary, they find out they have a psychologist get involved, a psychiatrist get involved. They're doing all these interviews with Morgan, and Morgan ends up getting diagnosed with a severe version of schizophrenia, where she cannot distinct, reality from something that is not real. And then that's when Morgan's mom kind of breaks down and says her father is schizophrenic, but he has control over it to the point where he can tell what is real and what is not. So as an audience member, you're like, light bulb, oh, this is probably definitely some sort of a hereditary gene that has been passed down from the father to the daughter. And it's sad. Her dad was crying. Morgan's father was like saying he really wanted to... he didn't know his daughter was suffering from this at all, and he wishes he would have had the time to help her get through it. She is on antipsychotic drugs at this point while she's still being held in the asylum for the murder or attempted murder of Peyton Bella. I mean, I do think that the drugs are being kind of court-ordered. According to her parents, though, it doesn't sound like her father was ever on any sort of antipsychotic drugs, so that tells you that she must have been diagnosed with a severe version of schizophrenia. During the interviews, what I did find interesting when they were asking her about the stabbings of Peyton, because remember, Morgan is the only one that physically stabbed her. Morgan doesn't cry. Morgan's very solid. It's a very, as a matter of fact, this is what happened. She didn't really get upset. It was very strange, but it was very much like a routine. It was planned. We had talked about it for months. Why should I feel guilty about it? It was something we'd planned. I found that to be very cold, and unfortunately, that is where you get like the serial killer like vibe going, is when someone has no remorse for hurting a human being or an animal for that matter. Especially when they found all these mutilated Barbies, you kind of have to sit back and be like, okay, there's something really wrong with this person. Like, this person is not mentally stable to be a normal functioning part of society. So the next question is, how does it end with Morgan? Well, like I said before, Morgan has been determined that she will not be able to stand trial because of her seeing Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and everything else. She has not gone outside since she has been withheld, whether it was jail at first or a psych ward. And she refuses to go outside, according to her parents, because she thinks the Slender Man is out there. Something I found really interesting during the interview is that she was completely convinced that the Slender Man was visiting her in her dreams the whole time they were planning it. Even now, she believes he is telepathically communicating with her. She believes he can teleport into her jail cell. They, I think, have had her on camera talking to someone, but that person's not there. She's all by herself. One other piece of the interview that I thought was crucial was the mother was on the phone with her one night while she's in this psych ward. And her mother said, you know, what do you like to watch on television? Because she has a television in her room. Morgan's answer was, it depends on how many people are in here and who decides. And Morgan's mom said, but don't you have a room all by yourself? And Morgan says, yes. So she has multiple personalities, which is the schizophrenia that's affecting her. According to Morgan, she refuses to go outside because of the Slender Man. She says she has no reason to go outside because of the Slender Man. She doesn't even have a window to access. So she has been incarcerated basically since this event happened in 2014, still refusing to either look out the window or go outside. She has a complete fear of it. So sadly, with Morgan, we can definitely say there is a severe mental illness going on. And let's hope that for her sake, the antipsychotics work. The lawyers were attempting to file for both of the girls to be tried in a juvenile court, but they're not going to be. The judge determined because it was attempted murder, he wants them to stand trial as adults to make sure that they never get out and do this again. They are both facing up to 65 years in prison, and this year, 2017, they will be going on trial for the attempted murder of Peyton, aka Bella. So by the end of the documentary, I was really concerned with Morgan due to the fact that she obviously has such a severe mental illness. Did Anissa know something was wrong with her friend? And did she use that to manipulate her into this scenario, knowing just that something wasn't quite right? So during the interviews with the police, Anissa did cry. She did break down a couple of times and cry regarding Peyton and Bella. So she did show remorse for the fact that she was stabbed, that she was hurt. However, I'm not sure if her mental illness is as bad as Morgan's. You know, I don't know if you've ever known anyone with schizophrenia. I have known some people with slight multiple personality disorders, and they are completely convinced, you know, no joke, that there are multiple people involved in their life, in their head. With Anissa, I didn't see that. I didn't see that she had something, you know, to that extreme, but she was on YouTube. They had basically scoured their computers, their iPads, and their Google Gmail accounts, and they found that Anissa had been watching some really vile videos online, different videos about soft spots of the body. If you murder someone, where's a good spot to, you know, attempting to take out first. She was watching videos on animals, the circle of life of you know, certain animals eating other animals, you know, the kind of torment of things, of items. She was researching different, you know, things like definitions of sociopath, psychotic. She was claiming that she was psychotic, that she was a sociopath. She left public comments on all of these different videos that she would watch, praising the person or the, you know, instance that it was revolving, and she'd always include herself to be a part of it. So once I realized that, you know, during the documentary, I was like, this girl has something wrong too, but it's not the schizophrenia side. It's that, like, serious serial killer side. Like, you know, if you've even heard Charles Manson, you know, have, you know, discussions on TV about the Manson murders and stuff. He has no remorse, and he's very, it's just that criminal mind of being very, you know, all-knowing as far as, like, the murders go and how the murders occurred, and having, like, a thought planned out that is such a criminal path. And that's what scared me with Anissa, because I was like, wow, this girl, like, got into biology, you know, like, got down to the biology of how to kill somebody. And that's really scary, like, when you're 12 years old. And, you know, at 12, I was, like, playing outside, like, I was sledding and, like, riding my bike. I wasn't trying to plan how to murder someone. And sadly, I guess that's what the window of the internet has opened up. So Anissa, you know, her parents were very upset. They actually divorced, I believe, ever since this occurrence happened. But they do go help visit her while she's being incarcerated. It does not sound like Anissa is being held in an asylum type of space like Morgan is. It sounds like Anissa's parents really have hope that she's going to get off of this charge because Morgan did the stabbing and Anissa didn't, but she was still kind of a mastermind behind it. So Anissa was pretty much just really obsessed with the Slender Man. And she had theories behind the Slender Man that he actually had been a little boy at one point that was bullied. And he grew up to be this big man that wasn't scary when he was around kids, but he would take the children with him and save them from being bullied. And Anissa's teacher was even involved in part of the interview of the documentary. Her teacher said that Anissa had always been picked on. She was kind of the lone wolf. She never played at recess with the other kids. She would come in during recess and even sit with the teacher and just do extra homework. And she had signed his yearbook previously before this happened, and in the yearbook told him that she thanked him for everything he'd always done and he was like a second father to her. So she was always this like lone wolf out, and it seems like she found some sort of protection with the Slender Man. She felt like he could protect her. He understood what she was going through. And so it seems like she was so desperate to get to the Slender Man that he could save her from, you know, this pain that she was experiencing of being bullied and being different, and that nobody really understood her. Anissa's parents did say that they knew she was into creepypasta, that she was reading The Slender Man. They too felt that it was very innocent because Anissa was actually involved in extracurricular activities. She was going to like an honor school and honor programs. She was really smart. And she was also involved highly with her choir. She was always singing, they said, on her iPad. With other kids in her choir class. So it's very interesting. It seems that she was kind of leading like a double life. Anissa did cry. She did say that she felt bad for Bella, but you do have to go back for a minute and remember that Anissa is the one that slammed Bella's head into the brick wall in the bathroom because she didn't want her to look her in the eyes while she killed her, which is really a criminal serial killer sort of statement, right? For someone to say that, like a lot of things we've known from, you know, Snapped and all those other documentary shows that they have out there, is that a lot of the times when there's a serial killer, they don't like to look their victims in the eyes. And so that was really scary to me, that at 12 years old, she had depicted the puzzle of a serial killer. In my opinion, who is responsible more than the other? I mean, they're both equally responsible, obviously. I know that, you know, Morgan did do the physical stabbing, which was really scary in the interview. She said, I think the police officer asked her, well, what did it feel like as you were stabbing Bella? And she was like, nothing. And she's doing this hand motion, and she's like, it felt like air. It felt like butter. It just felt like a knife and butter. And it's really sad because towards the end, Morgan's parents had accepted that Morgan will never get out of jail. Like, she's gonna be there for the rest of her life, or I'm sorry, in this asylum is where they're holding her. And Morgan's parents feel like that's where she belongs. Like, it's sad, but like her mental health is really bad, and that's where she needs to be. Anissa, on the other hand, her parents sound hopeful that she's gonna be getting out, and they feel like, you know, they want to kind of blame Morgan and Morgan's family and the schizophrenia that Morgan has, and basically that it was all Morgan's fault. So this leads into the third part of my discussion, which is, how does all of this affect or relate to paranormal blogging and reviewing like I do? Well, Creepypasta is a paranormal site, basically, right? Like, it's legends that people from little towns all over the world can bring these local legends and lore to life. And they start like the Slender Man did in 2009. It starts with two or three pages, and everyone starts contributing, and pretty much it ends up being this gigantic story that leads kids into murder. So not too long ago, I sat down with some of my producer friends, And, you know, we all kind of chatted about the paranormal superhighway and how it could affect people in the real world. So the question is Slender Man an actual demon? Because he is depicted as a demon. He has these huge, like, tentacles that come out. Maybe they're multiple arms. Nobody really knows. He abducts children. They think he's from the underworld. And they actually have depicted him similar to Jack Skellington from The Nightmare Before Christmas, which I disagree with because I'm a huge Nightmare Before Christmas fan, and Jack Skellington is way cooler than Slender Man. Sorry, it's just the truth. And he's definitely not abducting children. Well, kind of, you know what I mean. Zach, Aaron, Nick, when he was involved, they had a super paranormal highway set up going from Bobby Mackey's to, it was either the Washoe Club or Virginia City north of me, and then it went over to the Winchester House, right? And they were able to communicate with all three of the places and locations, and all of the entities were able to talk through EMF meters, through digital recorders, through spirit boxes. If you can set up a paranormal highway with just ghost gear, what makes you think that you can't do it with internet connections? Anyway, this was a show that I was working on with some of my production friends for a while, which was, can creepypasta or local legends and lore, the Slender Man, whatever, can these get such high vibrations because so many people get involved anonymously creating this character, this legend, this demon? If there's enough people putting their energy, which is what EMFs are, right? That is what we study as paranormal investigators. If there's enough people contributing to this image of Slender Man, is it impossible to say that he couldn't come to life? Now, wait a second. Does that mean that the Slender Man has risen from, down below? No. My theory behind it with my other producer friends was, demons are known for being mischievous. If you've ever interacted with the serious dark side, I'm not talking about the stupid shows that we watch all the time. They're like, it's a demon, it's a demon. No, it's not always a demon. It's really freaking rare. But when you run into the darkness, you know it. But my question is, if these dark entities like to depict children or something innocent, so you go towards it. That's what they've been known for. Most of the interactions with, like, complete dark bad stuff has been, you know, very fraudulent. They like to depict themselves as a child so that you walk up to it and trust it. Could one of these dark entities, you know, understand and be able to manipulate the internet and what all of these people are putting in their energy towards, which is such as an energy called the Slender Man, could it detect or depict what Slender Man looks like just because of all of the energy that the thousands of people have put into it? It's a good theory. I don't know if it's actually legitimate. That's why that show didn't get sold when we were kind of pushing it and pitching it. But I like that theory. Entities are so dark, and I think that this would be the perfect opportunity for them to become alive, per se, here on Earth, except not have to be themselves. They can kind of take on another image of something else. When you hear Morgan talk about the Slender Man, and you have to listen to her interviews, you can't just read about it. She talks about the Slender Man visits her in her dreams, visits her in the bedroom, visits her when she's, you know, now in, he teleports to her. And I know that Voldemort, and there's all kinds of other crazy stuff, and the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, but we all are into paranormal, usually because we have had an experience with something, good or bad. You guys know most of my experiences. This girl is totally believing that the Slender Man is real. There is no question in her mind that he doesn't exist. I do know that the schizophrenia has taken its toll. I understand now that she's on antipsychotics. But even after the drugs, she still says he visits her. She still refuses to go outside. She still refuses to even look out a window. She hasn't been outside in years because She thinks he exists. She thinks he can teleport to her. She thinks that this thing is legitimate. I know it sounds like a really far-fetched theory, but I have seen and experienced so many things in paranormal that sometimes things don't surprise me anymore. I don't believe in coincidences anymore. I feel really bad for all of these families involved. Mental illness, obviously, was a huge player in this. There is no excuse for what was done. No one deserves to be stabbed. No one deserves to have their friends, you know, distrust them and lure them into a horrible situation the way they did this poor girl named Peyton and Bella, and thank God that she survived. They actually had to bulldoze the forest where Peyton was stabbed and where she crawled to, because so many people were flying to this little town in Wisconsin trying to become a part of the Slender Man's history and creepypasta. And that tells you the day and age that we live in with the internet and how strong it is, and how strong legends are and creepypasta is. And I was so excited that I got to watch this. It was amazing. If you guys get a chance, try to find it. It'll probably be out on the internet, on HBO Go, who knows, try to look it up. It was great. And my question to you is, not necessarily with the Slender Man, but knowing that technically Google, the internet, could be a paranormal highway, do you think something could come to life? Not necessarily the Slender Man, but kind of the way Ghost Adventures did it with the superhighway. We've been able to prove that at this point. Do you think it would be strong enough to create something like this scenario? With or without mental illness? Just out of curiosity. Let's just play devil's advocate and talk about it. I'd love to hear what you guys have to say about it. What did you guys think about the documentary? Did you get to watch it? What do you think about Anissa? What do you think about Morgan's reactions? Do you think it was very strange? Did you also think it was the very serial killer vibe going on? I love when you guys leave me good comments below. I love to hear your opinions on everything. We'll be doing a giveaway very soon. I promise I'll announce it when we get a little bit closer to 1 million views. We're almost there. Please give my video a thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. Tell me what you guys want to chat about next, and I will catch you guys next time. We're back from dead. From the dead.